I want to start off this morning just by saying that sometimes it's good to refresh ourselves in basics, right? Sometimes it's good to just go back to the basics and try to understand how things work. I was reading not too long ago about how some people have learned to walk in a way that wasn't healthy for them to walk in. You ever known somebody like that? That they would have their feet turned out too much, and they'd walk on more on the sides of their feet. They may have their feet turned in too much, and they would walk, and it would, over the course of their lives, it wasn't the way the body was designed to work. It would compensate. You'd build up calluses and muscles in different ways, but eventually your joints weren't created to walk that way, and they'd begin to give out, right? And you'd have feet problems, you'd have knee problems, you'd have hip problems, and we all know that when those things start to go, your back starts to go, right? And it just affects the rest of your body, and it's just a nightmare, right? So I never really thought about it, but people don't really teach you how to walk, right? Nobody teaches you how to walk. You just kind of start figuring it out, right? I mean, maybe I'm alone in this, but anybody ever show you, okay, this is the way your foot's supposed to go and do that for you? No? No, you just kind of figured it out, right? Yeah, okay. So that's the idea, is that sometimes you just got to go back to basics. We got to kind of figure some things out. And sometimes it's hard to change habits, isn't it? You know, you're walking one way forever. Have you ever thought about that? Somebody pointed out to me that my feet do kind of go in a Y sometimes, which is why I was looking up the article and, you know, that kind of stuff. And so, like, sometimes, I'm not too concerned about it, but sometimes I'll, like, actually focus on walking with my feet directly in front of me, and, like, that's hard. It's harder than chewing gum at the same time while you're walking, right? Because you gotta change the way all your muscles work and muscle memory and stuff like that. So that's all a big introduction to just say that for the last year or so, I've been trying to study some of the basic tent poles of Christianity and the faith. And that leads you down many, many different rabbit holes. If you've been in one of my groups ever, you know that I'll come in sometimes just like on one topic. And you guys are like, well, I thought we were going to study this. And I'm like, no, we're going to study this tonight because I'm interested in it. So so that's why my groups sometimes get frustrated with me because they're like, I don't understand. But I'm in kind of studying these things. What do I believe? Why do I believe it? Have you ever asked yourself that question, those two questions? What do I believe? And probably more importantly, why do I believe it? Because I was brought up in a Christian home, right? My parents went to church. Church was life for me. And that's where I found friends. And because friends at school teased me and bullied me. And I was a sad little kid. No, I'm kidding. I did have... there was one person that was a bully, but that's all right. We grow up and sometimes we just assume that those are the way that things work. And we never challenge why they work that way. We never challenge why I even think that way. So I think both of these questions are paramount that every believer in Jesus Christ needs to kind of return there periodically and ask ourselves these questions. What do I believe and why do I believe it? Why do I worship God? Someone at group this week asked the question, do you believe in God or do you believe God? And I thought that was a little bit profound, right? Do I believe in God or do I just believe God? Which is kind of interesting. I thought it was thought-provoking. So one of the things that I've been chewing on in this process is the process of becoming a Christian. Like, what makes someone a Christian? What makes someone a believer? Right? What is that? What is at one point that you're like, you believe, right? Was it when Billy Graham touches somebody's head and says, you believe? When a televangelist, when they fall back and they're healed, is that at that point? Is it when they pray a prayer or is it when they're baptized? What is it? At what point do you call someone a Christian? Somebody want to give me an answer? When they get it. The sort of an answer, yeah. But when do you get it? Because I don't get some of the things that are in the Bible, do you? Do you understand it all? Because you should be up here teaching if you do. No. So at what point does someone become an adequate labeled believer? Okay, that's one answer. There's lots of things. For example, for me, my upbringing in the church, what I was taught was that the day that you were baptized, that was when you were considered a Christian. That's what I was taught, okay? And that's going to challenge what some of you believe, all right? that ultimately, unless baptized, your ticket to heaven wasn't accepted. It didn't get punched and you didn't get in, right? You had to be baptized. That was the gateway thing. Now, that brings up all kinds of fears in the hearts of Christians. It brings about an odd motivation in us too, because fear as in, I had a family member that wasn't baptized. Does that mean that they're not getting into heaven, even though they went to church, even though they claimed Christ as Lord and Savior, even though X, Y, Z number of circumstances? Does that mean they're not going to heaven, right? Fear as in deathbed confessions of faith are no longer relevant. It doesn't matter. Right? If you got to be baptized to get into heaven, if that's what gets your ticket punched, then what about that? Weird motivations such as emphasizing the act of baptism over a faith in Jesus Christ. Another weird motivation that now if baptism is what gets you into heaven, then we got to baptize the babies, right? Because if they're not baptized, they're not getting to heaven. If something happens, something tragic happens, they're not going to be in heaven. And we don't, I mean, come on, they're babies. That's what we want them in heaven, right? All right. So it's weird. It definitely doesn't seem right, does it? It doesn't seem right. Now, I'm purposefully trying to challenge your minds right now. So if that's what you believe, I hope you're challenged. So then you see a conflict in Scripture, all right? So Romans 10:10, for with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. That's pretty clear, isn't it? Isn't it? You can agree with me today. That's okay. It's pretty clear, even though you're like, I'm not really sure where he's going with this yet. It's going to be clear in a second, okay? That's pretty clear, right? There's nothing fuzzy about that. If the heart believes, if in your heart you believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and if you believe that, if you believe that Jesus died for your sins, then God would declare you just. And with the mouth, if you were to say that Jesus is my Lord and Savior, if you confess that thing, what this says there, that person is saved. Then Romans 10:13 says, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So let's pack everyone that we possibly can into the palace of Auburn Hills, all right? And we just get them to repeat after me, all right? And say, Jesus, you're my Lord and Savior. And then boom, right? Everybody's saved.
Jesus, you're my Lord and Savior.
Right? Is it that simple? Obviously not. That's interesting, though. But then we see in Acts 2:38, Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Well, wait a second. Okay, so if Paul is saying in Romans that if the heart one believes and is justified, and the mouth one confesses and is saved, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, then that just seems real easy, right? That just seems like we got some work to do. We just got a prayer to pray. We just got some things to do. But then we got Peter, who's saying after they heard the gospel that you need to repent of your sins, that you need to be baptized, and then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, which Paul would also teach later is a seal, is a sign, is what preserves your soul, basically. So now we're like, oh my gosh, it's confusing, right? No wonder people don't like Bible study, right? Matthew 28:19-20, these are Jesus' words. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always to the end of the age. Oof. So is the moment of salvation a walk down an aisle when a preacher finishes a sermon and the invitation song is playing and you pray a prayer with somebody and say, yeah, I want Jesus to come into my life? Is that the point of salvation? Or is it when they pass under the water and they come up out of that? Is that when they're saved? Right? How many of you have ever asked those questions in your mind before? Yeah. Absolutely, right? It's confusing. I did a lot of research on this week. I've been doing it for over a year, trying to figure out who's right in baptism. And guess what I found out? They've been arguing over this for the last 2,000 years. You know? Because we have scripture that says different things. We have different purposes. And I think you have to understand the whole of the Jewish culture and the times that Jesus was talking and these people. And you have to take into account things that were assumed. And you have to look at all of these things. And it makes it very difficult to really come to a firm grasp on what's going on. But I think I got something that's going to make it kind of easy for us this morning to understand this a little bit. We're returning to basics. And we're going to talk about what does it mean to be a believer? What does it mean to be a Christian in this life? We have to look at the Bible. We have to look at examples. We have to look at all this stuff. So most of you know that, I've already mentioned that I basically grew up at church. I was in church a lot, most every time the doors were open, as they say. I actually got a key at one point. It was pretty neat. But my parents were involved. My mom was on staff. In the summer, my sister and I would go to work with her sometimes. Some days we'd spend terrorizing the place. One of my favorite stories was that we were messing around, and our youth pastor would sometimes he'd bring up his Sega Genesis, right? And anybody know what that is? It's video games. Okay. It was the first video game system I owned. My parents had Atari and Nintendo, but they got me a Sega for one Christmas. But it was after he poisoned my mind with the idea of video games, right? And so sometimes he'd bring it to church, and so we could go to church, and I'd be going to church to play video games, right? And it would be exciting and everything. But anyway, he didn't bring it this particular day. And he was out of his office. He was there. His office was open. And so I got this really cool idea that I was going to go into his office. I was going to climb under his desk. He had one of those big old wooden desks, drawers on both sides, a piece of wood that came down the front. So you couldn't really see anything going on. And I was going to climb under his desk, hide under there. And when he came in to sat down, I was going to jump out and go, boo! And it worked perfectly. And I don't think the Sega Genesis showed up at church for about 3 months at least after that because he was so mad at me. And it was great. It was one of my favorite things that ever happened there. So we terrorized the place. But I remember when we didn't have things to do or when we were bored or whatever, we'd go in the nursery or we'd go in the toddler rooms or whatever, and they'd have toys in there. You know, like I mean, we had a pizza that Velcroed together, you know, and weird things. And there was little Bible stories and books and kids' Bibles and stuff. And so, you know, you get bored, you just start doing things that you wouldn't normally do, right? So playing with the Velcro pizza and looking through the children's Bibles. And one of the stories that always showed up in those things was Noah's Ark, right? How many of you are familiar with the idea or the story of Noah's Ark in the Bible? Okay, so we're on a basic even playing field here, but the idea is that it's one of the most beloved stories in the Old Testament, is it not? One of the things that most everybody knows. It's probably one of the first stories that kids learn growing up in Sunday school. And it's got all the cuteness to appeal to a kid. Families, animals, boats, a little bit of danger and a rainbow, right? You got all these cool little colorful things that you can just capitalize on. And it was one of the murals on the wall at church at one point. And I believe it was another pastor that brought it to my attention that it's just kind of an odd children's story. Because if you know the story, it's actually quite terrifying. It's God's judgment on a wicked world. And a lot of people died. Like, we think the Titanic is tragic. This is Titanic times 100,000, right? It's kind of could be a horror movie. Wait, somebody did that already, right? Let's highlight the story. Genesis 6, we're just going to hit the highlights. We're not going to read through it. I just want to bring something out here. It says, "Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with violence. And God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt. For all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, I have determined to make an end of all flesh, for the earth is filled with violence through them. Behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Make yourself an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark and cover it inside and out with pitch." Skipping to verse 17. "For behold, I will bring floodwaters upon the earth to destroy all flesh in which is the breath of life under heaven. Everything that is on the earth shall die, but I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall come into the ark, you, your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives with you. So God created the world. Just to give you a synopsis, he created the world and everything in it. The fall happens, man becomes sinful, becomes not a good species, right? Time passes, man procreates, we get to the time of Noah where basically everyone is evil. There is no law governing the place. It's just another book of the Bible would say that they were eating and marrying and drinking, and they were just partying. They were having a good time. They were enjoying life is basically the idea that you get from that, but it was wicked. And so God sees Noah, and the text says that God found favor with Noah, that he was a righteous man. And it wasn't a perfect man, but he was a righteous man, right? So God sets up a covenant with him and says, build a boat because I'm going to flood the world. You're going to need a raft. And so think about this for a moment. There's no Home Depot or Lowe's yet, right? There's no lumber yards that have come into business, and we don't have corporations, we don't have mass machinery to create these things, right? If you needed a saw, you had to make it. Ryobi and DeWalt weren't making them yet, all right? If you needed a nail, you had to make it. It wasn't, they were not in existence anywhere. You had to handcraft everything. So the ark was 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, 30 cubits tall. That gives you a great image, doesn't it? It's fantastic. What's a cubit? A cubit is a measurement, because they didn't have metric or standard measurements yet. A cubit is from your elbow to the tip of your longest finger. Now, if we all went around and compared, do you think we would all have the same length of cubit in this room? No, no. And to make it worse, you know how our features change based upon our history and our race, right? So you would have different, you know, European might look a little bit different than us today, but we're definitely different from Russian or Chinese or Germanic descent. You know, we've got different body features and we've evolved and not evolution. We've changed. be careful with that word, but it would be different. And so if you go online and you punch in, you know, how big was the ark, it's going to give you a couple of different things about how big it was. Now, I'm going to go with Answers in Genesis because they just built this attraction, the Ark. How many of you heard of this? It's in, Tennessee or Kentucky? I can't remember which one. It's Kentucky. They have this awesome museum, and they just built a full-scale replica of the Ark, and you can go tour it, you can go get in it, and see what it was like and see it for yourself in person, which is amazing. I've seen pictures of it. I haven't been there yet. Even Bill Nye, the science guy, went there, which I thought was pretty cool, but I'm sure they duked it out. So anyway, the idea is that we're not exactly sure in feet and inches or meters or whatever we can measure exactly how big it was, because all we had was cubits, and we would have to know Noah's cubit in order to actually measure this thing out. So I'm going to go with Answers in Genesis. Here's what they say. They say it was 510 feet long. Okay, just to give you an idea, that's 1.5 football fields, approximately. Okay, that's long. Right? You could fit 3 space shuttles on its deck. All right? Maybe that'll help you a little bit. That's a long ship. Noah had to go cut the trees down, turn them into lumber. But before he could do that, he had to make the saws to go do that, right? Or the axe or whatever he used to cut it down. Then after he got it turned into lumber, he had to make the wooden nails. I don't know what you call them, shims. You'd have to make all these things and put them together. Then you'd have to go extract the pitch from the trees in order to cover it, right? This is a long process, right? This is not even building a house. This is build the Titanic with no tools. You know? So when God says build an ark, it's not like, oh, let's go sailing, right? He's saying build a monumental piece of architecture so that you can be saved. This is not a project you're going to accomplish next weekend. This is not a project you're going to accomplish within the next decade. This is a project that is going to take a majority of your life, all right, to finish. So it's 510 feet long, 50 feet tall at its roof, so a 4-to-5-story building, okay? It could store, for cargo, it could store nearly 450 semi-trailers worth of cargo. 450 semi-trailers. It's a big ship. No tools, no help that we know of. It's a massive undertaking. So for years, Noah's building this ark. It was a decades-long sacrifice. Think about what would happen today if somebody comes up to you and was like, hey, I'm having a party at my house. Gonna be some friends there. We're going to play some cards and have a good time. You want to come? And your response is, well, I'd love to, but God kind of told me that I need to build a boat today. Okay. Great. I'll see you around then. He's like, no, not really. It's going to take me a while. It's, you know, it's 450 feet long or 510 feet long. It's going to be big. It's going to take me a lot of time, you know. And all right, gotcha. So, yeah, God's going to kill everyone on the earth, just so you know. You know. What? Okay. Well, send me an invite when that time comes, and I'll come join you on your boat, you know. Got to, you know, that would be our response, right? Just kind of like, you're kind of nuts. You go do your thing. I'm going to go party, all right? We're going to take care of this. So, can you imagine... Can you imagine what Noah's wife thought? Honey, the dishwasher's broken. Sorry, I got to build a boat. God told me to build a boat. That's the ultimate trump card, isn't it? Oh, man. God told me I need to work. Sorry, hon, God's orders. It's fun. We can think about some of these things. Obviously, they did have dishwashers. But we know from the text that despite the certain frustrations, definitely got some slivers. Right? If he made a hammer, he smacked his thumb a few times. Absolutely. We know, not necessarily from the text, but we know that he had to have been ridiculed. Right? I mean, at this point, the earth is fairly new. We're not sure that a flood has ever happened at this point. So to say a worldwide flood is going to happen... And they don't have CNN to report on anything going on in the world, right? Even if it is fake news, right? So, despite all these things, here's what we see, is that Noah just said yes. Genesis 6:22. Noah did this. He did all that God commanded him. We don't see that Noah asked any questions. We just see that he said yes. He got to work. It was a lifelong work. But he built an ark. And what was the result of him building an ark? When the floodwaters came, what happened? He was saved. Noah was saved. This is a salvation story. And I believe it's in here not because God wanted to show just simple things about how he promised never to flood the world again, but he wanted to show how redemption works, how salvation works. So walk with me through some logic for a minute. The ark saved Noah, right? You shaking your head, yes? You're feeling like I'm going to try and trap you. Okay, I understand that. But yeah, I mean, logically, if you look at that, if he didn't have the ark, he would have drowned, right? The ark saved Noah. It was the device that allowed him to float. It was something that he walked through that. So you could say that out of Noah's obedience came salvation. Out of Noah's obedience came salvation, because had he not obeyed, he would not have had an ark to get into in the first place. No salvation. Now, God could have came out and was like, boom, here's an ark, you know. He could have done that. But for whatever reason, he asked Noah to build the ark. He asked him to work on it, work it out. He asked him to do it. But you might say, if we're looking at this as a parallel for how salvation works, the Bible is explicitly clear that salvation is not our doing. Look at this text from Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. It says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. So if we back up a little further in our thought process about what saved Noah from the flood, If God hadn't extended some sort of grace to Noah, informing him of the flood, giving him instructions on building the ark, then Noah would have been swept away with the flood as well. And so God is the source of our salvation then, right? And that fits in with what we just read in Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9. But if we look at Noah's life, it still wouldn't have worked if Noah didn't respond in a life-sacrificing way. Right? Noah built the boat. He built the ark. God sent the water, but Noah still built the boat. It doesn't say whether or not God lent him a hand. You know, I'm sure there had to be a day when he was looking at another tree and he would just look up at the heavens and go, God, can you just like, you know, knock this one over for me because I'm tired. It doesn't say that God did that for him. It's not beyond God to do that for him. But Noah built the boat. He obeyed. He just said yes. He just said yes. And if he hadn't said yes and submitted to God's instructions, then he wouldn't be here despite God's extension of mercy and grace and saying, hey, I'm going to kill the world. So you might want to get to work. So this leads us to only one conclusion that I could come up with, is that faith in God or salvation or becoming a believer is kind of a two-part system. All right? God speaks, so God declares, right? God acts in some way. And those who claim him as God respond. Everyone else just doesn't. They may hear it and be like the guy that was inviting you to the party and be like, I'll see you later. God speaks truth, you live it out. Right? Just say yes. Say that.
Yes.
No. Just say yes. I knew that was going to confuse you, and it was going to make me giggle a little bit. But yeah, that's the idea I want you to take today, is just say yes. Just say yes. None of this, but I don't think it'll work. How many times do we tell God that? Are you really sure about that, God? I'm not really sure that's the right thing we should be doing. You read a text in the Bible, and you're like, are you kidding me? Right? We look at Old Testament especially, and how life worked in the Old Testament, and we're like, are you serious? Like, you're going to stone them for that? And not the happy stoning, all right? It's the other kind of stoning, right? Like, death is a result of that. So, we're going to be coming in contact with more of that, so we might as well identify with it now, right? This way of life sometimes is we have it kind of figured out, but what does the Bible say? That God's ways are not our ways. And sometimes we're going to look up in the heavens and we're going to look at God and we're just going to go, are you for real right now? And then we're going to start asking a lot of questions. We're going to start seeing some things. I don't think it's going to work. Is there another way? Just say yes. Just say yes. None of this running from God, searching out happiness somewhere else. Just say yes. Right? God speaks, and you can't just listen. Let me just put it to you like this. If God spoke to us right now, audibly, so that we could all hear it, and he declared in a voice,
hello, rising. I love you, right? I want you to serve me.
Now, I think he'd be way more articulate than that. But if he spoke to us, I know, hopefully God does not sound like me because I don't have that awesome booming voice to do that with, but here's a little side note just to make you giggle. I still think it'd be awesome if God's voice is really way up here and you just talk to us like that. God's ways are not our ways, right? So what we think is big and powerful is really, you know, not that way. I know, lightning might strike through the ceiling right now, but it's okay. I think God has a sense of humor too, but if God spoke to us right now, you know, And he just said, listen to me. How many are you going to listen? Even if I didn't hear him and I kept talking, are you going to be listening to what I'm saying right now? No. At least you shouldn't be. And if God spoke to you right now, how many of you are going to start moving your head, looking around, where is that coming from? Is your spirit going to move at all? Because I noticed that when you read about the Apostle Paul, when Jesus appeared to him on the road to Damascus, right? He didn't know who it was, but he still called him Lord. And I think that's sometimes how we might respond, is we're not really sure what's going on right now, but we know it's more powerful than us because it's not coming from the lips of anything that we can see. And it's not coming out of our speakers or anything like that, right? And we still be like, whoa, God, is that you? We would respond. Because what's going to happen that day, no matter what his message is, you're going to walk out those doors or that door. And what are you going to remember from today? God spoke to you. He's real. He thought that I was valuable enough to say words to in a way that he doesn't speak to many other people. Are you going to go out to lunch and just, you know, go about your day? I don't think so. I really don't think that would be the case. You know, whatever you got planned, if you're going to go down to Sam's Coney Island or Detroit Burger Bar or whatever it is, you're not going that way. You might end up kind of crazy walking down the streets going, God's alive, right? I think that when God speaks, you can't just listen. I mean, how many of you are just simply going to be smiling, right? That'll just change your day. That'll change your life to hear from God. But I think that some of us would go running out of here motivated to tell the world because you just heard the voice of God. No more doubting, no more questions. I heard it. He wants me to go. He loves me. People are going to think you're nuts. But if God spoke to you right now and told you what I've preached to you before, coming from his word, that he loves you, that he'll protect you, that he'll go with you, that he wants you to bring his name glory in any way that you possibly can. You're not going to go to lunch and then go home and take a nap. Your life is going to change. So when we see for ourselves the words that are written on the page, when we open our Bibles and we read these words that God himself has authored, why do we sit back and go, it might be that way, but I'm not really sure I want to test it out right now, right? I got some other things I want to take care of first. When I get past this project, I'll go help the church. When I get a raise, I'll start giving tithes and offerings. When I learn a little more about the Bible, then I'll start telling people about the gospel because they wouldn't want to hear it from me now. When I get a little older, I'll be more capable of self-control and sin less. You know, what is that in us that does that to ourselves, right? That's not just saying yes. That's not just going, God, I believe you. I believe in you. I want to worship you. How can I serve you? That is not just saying yes of going, well, we'll wait a few days. I got some other things I need to take care of first. Those excuses don't sound like belief, do they? Oh, but I believe in God, some of us might say. James 2:19. You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. With your lips, you might revere God. You might shout amen. You might say hallelujah when I say something that's truth from the Bible, right? When somebody else says truth from the Bible, when you listen to televangelist or something like that, it makes you feel good. It makes you charged up. But even the demons do that. So what makes a believer different from a demon, right? Even the demons believe and they shudder. Even the demons revere God to the point of trembling. Do you? Step on some toes. Do you? Do you believe in that God? What makes a believer different? This is what makes a believer different. They hear God's truth and it changes their lives. That's what makes a believer different. They hear God's truth and it changes their lives. And they just say yes. Now, I want to be clear with this. It doesn't mean that we don't think critically about the scriptures. It doesn't mean we turn into brainwashed robots that go, Jesus is alive, right? We don't do that stuff. We think critically. We look at scripture. We chew on it. We go, there seems to be a conflict here. Why is that? And we dig into our faith. But at the same time, we go, okay, God is infinitely smarter than I am. I want to believe in Him. I want to submit my life to Him. So in some of these things, I don't understand. I don't even want to do some of these things, but I'm just going to say yes. I'm just going to say yes. I'm going to hold back the question. Because what happens when you start asking questions, right? It's a lot like what happens when I ask for a volunteer when I have an object lesson. I don't have one today, so rest easy. But everybody looks at you and goes, what do I got to do? Right? That when I ask you guys for somebody to come up here, what do I got to do? And then, do I got to eat something? Am I going to embarrass myself? Am I going to win something? Right? All the questions start coming. Why? You don't trust me. For good reason. I'm not saying that's not, you know, I mean, I have kind of a silly mind sometimes. When you do that to God, what's that mean? You don't trust Him very much, at least in that moment. So therefore, do you believe God? Do you believe God? But if you don't trust Him, do you believe Him? It's a good question, isn't it? And I'm not going to answer that for you. You have to answer that for you. But it's a basic question, is it not? And that's why I wanted to return to basics, because I think there's something here. I don't know if a person is saved when they first hear the gospel, in their heart they accept Jesus, or if it's when they are baptized. I don't know that. And if you can hold to a tradition of a denomination that has taught it for years, and it doesn't bother me. You can believe what you want to believe and what you've been convinced of from Scripture, but it better be because you've been convinced of it from Scripture and not because some person told it to you. Because that's how we get into trouble over the years, right? Is it in the Bible? Can you show me in the Bible? Because I'll debate you all day long. I'll debate both sides because I love playing devil's advocate, right? And it's great, and I love, that's what iron sharpens iron, right? Proverbs 27:17, iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another, and we just grind on each other, and we're like, and we frustrate one another to the point of, okay, we got to stop for a while because I'm starting to not like you, right? And so we debate it, and we try to figure it out, and we chew on it, and we become more mature because of that, and we look at Scripture, and we see different sides of it, and it's awesome, but I don't know the answer to that question yet, nor have I picked a side, right? That's what people walk in, when you're checking out a church, right? You walk in, what do you believe about baptism? What do you believe about worship? I'm talking to a minister right now, two ministers right now, that belonged in non-instrumental churches. Oh, right? I'm a guitarist in a worship team, but they still like me, right? They still like me. We can put aside that thing right there and do that. Why? Because we believe in Jesus Christ. Here's what I do know. Acts 2:37-38. What has happened is the gospel has just been presented. Jesus has just ascended into heaven. We're in the second chapter of Acts. That happened in the first chapter of Acts. Peter is speaking about what has just happened to Jesus and the reality of that and the gospel message. And he said, now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, just like Noah heard a word of the Lord and responded in a mighty way, I believe it's a similar call in the life of all Christians. It's not just baptism. It's not just asking Christ to be our Lord. It's a combination of God's call and our continual response. Not just one-time response. Like, oh, I was baptized when I was a kid. Does that make me a Christian? Does it? Do you trust the Lord? Do you believe God? Do you believe in Him? That's probably what I would call the definition of a Christian more than anything, because Peter said, repent. He said, turn away from your sin. Turn away from the ways of the world. Literally, what that means is decide to change your thoughts. Decide to change your mind for the rest of your life. It's not in that moment, change your mind for everything that you're doing wrong. It is in that moment, hearing Jesus Christ proclaim Lord as Savior, decide that you want to follow after Him and that you will spend the rest of your life building, working out your salvation with fear and trembling. Decide. That's what repent means. 180 turn. I'm going to stop walking that way. And even though it feels like there's a rope pulling me this way, toward sin, toward blackness, that worked out really good. I didn't even think about that before now. Something I'm going to decide. I'm going to stop walking this way. I'm going to decide. It may take me a while. There are some things in my life, some habits that I've built up. I've been walking the wrong way for a long time in my life, but I've got to slowly change my habit so that I can walk toward the light. So what that means is when I learn that I'm doing something inconsistent with God's will, when I hear God's truth proclaimed and it doesn't match up with my life, what does that mean? I change. Way easier said than done. Let me just put that out there. But that doesn't make it an excuse. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. So once we've decided that, we enter into the waters of baptism by faith, identifying ourselves with Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. Look at what Paul wrote in Romans 6. He says, we were buried, therefore, with Him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in the newness of life. For if we have been united with Him in death like His, we shall certainly be reunited with Him in a resurrection like His. We know that our old self was crucified with Him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. There is nothing magical about the waters of baptism. When we eventually buy our baptistry, we're going to fill it with Lapeer City water, right? We're going to buy it for like 0.8 cents a gallon or whatever it is. They hold 100 gallons, so do the math. But it's just water. There is something to be said, though, for the response to God. There is something to be said for the response to God. And identifying yourself in a public way with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. I was reading story upon story, and they're all too long to share with you this morning, but I'd encourage you to look at this. We are so lucky in America. Because in a majority of other places around the world, baptism is a death sentence. Because it is your public proclamation. You're not going to submit to anyone in this world anymore. You are dying to this life. You are dying to yourself. And you will be ruled by a God who you can't dethrone. And that is a threatening thing to very many people. And in some ways, that's part of why baptism has lost its significance in our culture. I'm not claiming either way this morning. I don't want you to walk away from here thinking one thing or the other, because I think it's an avenue that you have to decide for yourself. I can present the evidence for both sides, whether baptism is the point of salvation or something else is. I do know this, is that Jesus commanded it. Be baptized. Baptize other people. Peter said, repent and be baptized. But guess what? I've taken baths in my life, right? My mom and dad bathed me as a child. They could have baptized me lots of times, right? Out of frustration even, right? Child, stop it, right? Because I wasn't repenting, it meant nothing. We can go under the water many, many times. But if it doesn't include the response to God's truth, not fear of hell, but response to God's love for you, that's the ticket, I believe, to being a believer, to being a Christian. I think sometimes we just make things way too complicated, and we want to know all the details before we make a decision, right? We do that today. We've been scammed too many times. We've been duped and we've been lied to, and there's those things that we get into and we fear that. I get like that a lot with decisions. I'm a slow decision maker. But here's what we need to know. First off, God loves you. I just need to tell you that. God loves you. Like, I don't know why you doubt that. I don't know what is in your life and what circumstances are going on around you right now to test you and to say that make you think that God doesn't love you. But I don't need you to hear those three words this morning, is that God loves you. The chances of you being here are astronomical. And I take God at his word when he says that we were fearfully and wonderfully made. Now, you might have a mole somewhere you think is unattractive. You might have no hair anymore. Or you might have hair where you don't want it. All right? But here's the bottom line, is that you were fearfully and wonderfully made. I take him at his word when he says that when we pass through the waters, he will be with us, that they won't overtake us. And I take God at his word that when we must walk through fire, we won't be burned or scorched. God loves you so much that he sent his one and only son, that whoever would believe in him wouldn't perish. But what? They would have eternal life. And I think that sometimes we just struggle to hear that. For whatever reason, our life just wants to keep those promises out because it feels so much better to feel bad. Sometimes we like the anger. How many of you have ever gotten angry and you're like, I really got to stop being angry, but I don't want to, right? Sometimes we've got to just release our own grip on some of these things. We struggle to hear it. And so our sin clouds our judgment. Our guilt separates us from him. We ask all these questions just to keep him at arm's length. And what he wants from us is just to let it down and just say yes. Yes, Lord. I know you love me. I know you're not going to let me drown. I know you're not going to burn me. I know that I'm going to go through things that I'm going to struggle through. I know that I'm going to struggle with my own faith. But God, bring me back to basics. Teach me how to walk and show me how to just say yes to you. God, I love you. God, I need you. God, I'll obey you. And maybe that's the prayer you need to pray this morning. And maybe for a time, I don't think this is a good lifestyle to just live by, but for a time, maybe you just need to commit to not asking any more questions for a little while. And just be silent. The only word that might come out of your mouth is yes. Yes, God. I believe, I agree. I'm going to live this way. I'm going to walk your way. Yes, Because the reality is that we are wicked, that we are blemished, that we are a wretch. But in your arms, God, with your Son, what we're saying when we repent, when we believe in Jesus, is that I believe that you will declare me blameless, that you will make me spotless, that I'll be innocent before you. I can have faith that you will take my sin from me. And so I just say yes. I give my life up to you. I believe. And today, what do we say? Just yes. Today, I want to encourage you to be a believer, to trust God, to repent of some of the sins that are in your life. You can't do it all today. All right, we're not here for that. But today you can decide no more walking toward the black, but walking into the light.